Good evening. Welcome to this time of prayer and Bible study with the people of St. Andrew's Baptist Church in Columbia, South Carolina. I'm Pastor D. Vaughn. On behalf of our staff and our membership, I'm so glad you've taken this time to be with us so that we can open our hearts to the Lord, both to share our needs and to listen for His guidance, that we can be in fellowship with one another as we pray and as we study. All of those are so important to our Christian lives, and I know we're missing the chances to be in person and study and worship and fellowship together. But aren't we thankful we have tools like this that allow us to be together, at least electronically? While we're together, I want you to share prayer concerns that you may have by entering comments onto Facebook. Remember that everyone will see them, so write them in a way that you're comfortable with everyone receiving them. And even if you don't have a specific prayer request, I hope you'll take a moment to sign in, because it does us all good to know that you're there. It gives us encouragement and strength to know that we're in the presence of God's people, and that we're sharing time in His presence together. So thank you again for being here and being a part of what God is doing. I want to tell you that I was part of a very happy celebration just a few days ago as we delivered the school supplies that you made possible for our partners in education at H.B. Rame Elementary School. Several of us took several vehicles full of school supplies to the office, and teachers and administrators were there and were just in awe of how much paper and composition books and notebooks and regular school supplies we were able to bring, but also the hand sanitizer, the disinfecting wipes, the masks, the tools that they'll need especially this year that they don't normally need to have a safe and effective year. So I want to say thank you for being a part of that ministry and touching the lives of those children as soon they'll be coming back to school. And we pray for their safety and their success in this new year of education. I want to mention some prayer concerns that I know of tonight and allow you to enter those on your heart as you share comments. We want to pray for Elwood Gerald, who has been a patient at Park Ridge Hospital. Elwood is doing some better and is going to be transferred to the Lohman home, we believe, as soon as a bed is available for him to do some rehab to build up his strength so that hopefully he can return home and be there with Miss Christine. But you pray for them as they navigate these waters of illness and pray that he'll be safe from COVID and all the other things that are out there right now. Deborah Todd has undergone knee replacement surgery and is recovering well, and we're happy to know that, glad that she is coming along. We want to pray for Mark Carman, that's Margaret Carman's son, who is presently a patient at our Baptist hospital. Pray that God will be at work in his life to bring help and healing to him. I want to ask you to be in prayer for my brother, Barry Vaughn. Barry has some health issues and has some decisions that he needs to make about how to seek treatment and help to solve those issues. So I hope that you'll pray for my brother, as he is precious to my heart, and that God will give him wisdom to know the best things to do. Pray for St. Andrew's Baptist Church, that we will see and seize our opportunities to minister in this unusual and strange time. It's a unique chapter of our church's story, but that means we also have some unique opportunities to serve God and to reach others. So pray that God will open your eyes and your heart to see those and give you courage to grab hold of them, because these are fleeting opportunities to help others know Christ and to find their place in His family, the church. Pray for us who are church leaders as we think about the community health situation and envision plans about when and how we might regather as a church family. We are encouraged to see that the incidence of new cases of COVID is down some these days. That's good news. We're going to see what happens as students return to school. And if the trends continue to be down, I hope we'll be ready to announce some plans before long about taking the first steps of being back together here in God's house. Wouldn't that be wonderful? Pray for our leaders of our state and our nation as they make important policy decisions. Pray for our nation in this election season, as there's so many evidences of being divided and at odds with each other. Pray that God will give us unity around what is true and what is right, what is just and what is loving. Pray for all of the medical workers who are seeking to serve us in this time of pandemic. They're putting their lives on the line so that we might save ours. So I hope you'll be in prayer for them. I saw an interview with a medical worker just a couple of days ago, and she said she loves her work. She has children at home and cares for her aging mother. And every time she comes home, she's worried that she might bring the virus into their home where it could be detrimental to the health of her children or even fatal to her mother. So many of these medical workers are facing that kind of dilemma and decision every time they go to work. Let's lift them up and look for opportunities to voice our thanks to them for what they're doing. And all the essential workers who are out there staying busy so that life can go on for us, even in this COVID time. I want to share a song with you tonight before we pray. This is one you may not have heard, or probably haven't heard often anyway. I heard this song first at my niece's wedding, which I had the great joy of officiating. When I say officiate a wedding, sometimes I feel like I'm labeling myself like a referee, you know, call a penalty for unnecessarily taking too long to say your vows or something. But I got to lead that worship service. That's the way I like to say it. And in their ceremony, they sang this beautiful song. And I fell in love with it, got a recording of it. It is just a very worshipful song and a chance for me to approach God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as the different verses speak to God and those persons through whom He's revealed Himself to us. This is called Wonderful, Merciful Savior, and I hope it will help lead you into a spirit and an attitude of prayer and worship. And after the song, we'll go to God together as we pray. In the meantime, share your prayer concerns through comments so that all of us can know how to support you and those who are on your heart right now. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. One that we praise, you are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. Into God's presence, into his throne as we pray. Father, who created us, who breathed the breath of life into us, Savior, who came into the world as one of us, to seek us, to save us, to make us your own now and forever. Spirit, who walks with us each day of our journey to give us your presence, to give us your power, to give us your peace. We come to you tonight, O God, in all of the ways that we've known you, to worship you and to bless your name, to open our hearts and to lift our needs to you. Lord, we've named some who have special health needs right now. We ask you to be at work in their lives and through the doctors and treatments and medicines, through the wisdom that you give people to choose what is best. Work in their lives to restore health and to bring fullness of healing. Father, I lift up those who are struggling emotionally during these days, when we've been more isolated, more withdrawn, less in touch with others. It's easy for dark and difficult feelings to gain a grip on our lives and weigh us down. I pray that you would shine light into each heart and that you would give us the guidance we need to overcome what is dark and be children of the light, living in the joyful confidence that we belong to you. Father, I pray for those who are healthcare workers, who are risking their lives each day for the good of our community. Protect them and their families as they are so willing to share and to sacrifice for the sake of all of us. We lift up our church to you during these days, Father, as we're wondering when the right time and the right way will be to regather as your people here at 230 Bush River Road. Give us wisdom and courage and confidence to know what is best and to do what is best. We ask you to open our eyes and our hearts to the opportunities we have to serve you right now that we may not have when we gather again. The people we can invite to share a broadcast with us, the people who might be willing to look at our church through the window of Facebook or YouTube who haven't felt ready to walk inside a church building. May they experience your love and our fellowship and be drawn to take their place in your family, in your body. As we turn to your word tonight, I pray that you would write upon our hearts those things that we most need to know and live by. Thank you that the same Holy Spirit who breathed your word into existence, breathed your truth into its pages. Breathe upon us to reveal your truth, to apply it to our lives, to strengthen us to be doers of your word. May that be our experience in the time we share now. In Christ's name. Tonight, we're going to take another step in our journey that I'm calling In the Presence of My Enemies. That beautiful picture from Scripture, from Psalm 23, talks about the life of the Christian. It doesn't deny that we face enemies. We certainly do. But it says because of who our host is, the one who's invited us to live in his tent, to be one of his people, and therefore to receive his provision and his protection. Psalm 23 makes the bold and beautiful claim that God prepares a table before us, even in the presence of life's enemies, and therefore life can be for us a feast. We can know the abundant life even when we know our enemies are present, even when we know there at work. Tonight we're going to talk about one of those enemies that causes so much stress and strain and tension, and it's one that is gaining a grip on many lives as we face the frustrations and the isolation and the limitations of the COVID pandemic, and that is anger. The enemy of anger that works within us to destroy us and hurt those around us. Tonight, we're going to look at some verses from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4, beginning at verse 25. They offer us a great deal of guidance and practical help in dealing with the enemy of anger. Paul writes, "Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you." I don't know an emotional challenge that is more difficult for Christians to manage wisely, faithfully, lovingly than anger. I think where we get into trouble is that we misunderstand the experience of anger. And many of us assume that if we feel angry, we're doing something wrong. That the feeling, the experience of anger, is in itself a sin. And that's not true. Anger is in some ways like an alarm system. Burglar alarm or a fire alarm that you may have in your home or at your place of work, that's there to signal us when danger is coming. Now, inside your body and mind, before we have time to think or decide or choose, sometimes we perceive something that's in our environment. Might be a person, could be an animal, could be just a situation. Something is a threat. And if we feel internally threatened, our body sounds the alarm. And one of the things that happens as our body is gearing up, getting ready to respond as strongly, as quickly as possible to either overcome that threat or get away from it, we often feel angry. Remember that anger is something God created. It is part of your human personality. And when it is managed, when we're in proper relationship with those feelings, it doesn't have to lead to sin. In fact, it many times can keep us safe. The problem comes when we don't handle anger in a wise, compassionate, loving kind of way toward ourselves and toward others. Notice where Paul starts in verse 25. He says, "Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body." So many of the times that we experience anger come from feeling that we've been deceived, that we've been misled, misinformed, that someone is not shooting straight with us. The practice of Christians needs to be to tell the truth and to trust each other enough to hear the truth. Now, there is a way to tell the truth. Earlier in this letter, Paul spelled it out in those beautiful words, speaking the truth in love, with a spirit of love, or we could say with the accent of love. I so enjoy hearing people from other parts of the world speak with their unique accent. It's like a new melody that I learn in speech. Paul says that when we speak the truth, people need to hear an accent. It needs to be clear to them that we're coming from a place of love, that we want to work through our problems, heal our differences, and restore our relationships. As he gets to verse 26, Paul makes a very important statement. Quoting Psalms 4, he says, "In your anger, do not sin." Notice that he hasn't said, "When you are angry, you are sinning." He didn't say that. He said that inside the experience of anger, you might sin, you might not. You have choices, you have habits you can develop, you have attitudes toward others and toward yourself that will shape what you do with that anger when it comes. Here's something I think that's very important to learning to manage anger in a Christian way and make it less of a threat and less of a source of stress and strife in our lives. When you or I feel anger, it's a secondary emotion. What I mean is, the anger is coming from something deeper that you and I are feeling. I sometimes describe it to people like a fighter in the Middle Ages lifting up a shield. You lift up the shield to protect yourself when you see that there's something threatening coming at you, a sword or an arrow or whatever the other person's weapon might be. When you and I find ourselves feeling angry, something is threatening us. It may be a physical threat. We may be in danger. But it also may be a threat to our sense of identity, our sense of well-being. It may be a feeling of injustice. One Christian writer, Lewis Smead, said that he thought the heart of anger was struggling with an experience of injustice. Sometimes that's true. I've been mistreated. You haven't treated me with love or respect, or you've neglected me or overlooked me. But remember that anger is secondary. And if you and I can have the maturity and the insight to see beneath the shield and see what's going on deeper inside our hearts, then we have a chance to unplug the energy of that anger before it does something that can be destructive. So learn to listen to your own heart and to ask the question, "What is inside me that feels hurt, that feels threatened, that feels mistreated. If you get to that, you can get to the issue instead of just striking out defensively. In your anger, do not sin. He goes on to say, do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. Deal with your anger in a timely way. Now, sometimes people need a moment, or more than a moment, to cool off. A number of times in my life, I have gotten up in a situation and said, I'm going to take a little walk, I'll be back. Or I've said, let's talk about this tomorrow. I'll be in a better frame of mind to discuss it then. There are times we need to cool down if we feel our emotions are so strong that they're blinding our hearts. But what we don't need to do is let anger go on and on and on unaddressed. Because as we do that, as we talked about in our study of Matthew 18, it just gets worse. The anger festers. It gets entangled with other hurts that we've suffered, and sometimes we can't pull it back apart and deal with it as one issue. We begin to imagine what the other person is thinking or feeling and act like mind readers. Only God can do that. So Paul says, you have an opportunity to deal with anger responsibly. But don't take forever, because that time will pass. What's so easy for us to do, what is so tempting, is to act as though it never happened. Now, outwardly we may choose to do that, but inwardly we remember. And we may see that anger leaking out in critical comments towards somebody, or little things we say to others about them, or just our new attitude toward them, a damaged, wounded attitude. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. Seize the moment to deal with it. I heard a couple say one time, we promised never to go to bed angry, and sometimes we have it slip for days at a time. Well, many times we can deal with our anger in a timely way and be done with it. Paul says one other thing in this section as you get into verse 27. He says, and do not give the devil a foothold. A foothold, a place to stand. It's like giving up part of your property. It's like someone coming and saying, I want to live on this corner of your yard. And you saying, okay, it's yours. Well, we certainly don't want Satan to be living in the corner of our lives or anywhere else. When we don't deal with anger in a Christ-honoring way, we're giving the devil a place to do his work, because he is working to make it worse, to divide us from the people who can love and support us and keep us faithful to Christ. He's working to mar our witness through irresponsible things we say or do. He's working to hollow out the witness of the church by us doing embarrassing and shameful things when we're mad. Paul says, you don't have an inch of your life to give to the devil. And when you're angry, he's asking for a place to stay, a place to work. And you better believe it, a place from which he will work evil in your life. When you're mad, all kinds of bad things can happen. Paul says, don't lollygag around and delay your response, because you're giving the devil a chance to move in. Let's don't do that. In verse 28, he changes topics just a bit, but it connects beautifully. Verse 28, he says, he who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. There was one of the early editions of the English Bible. It's called the Thief's Bible because a comma was misplaced in this verse. And so it read something like that. He who has been stealing must steal, comma, no more working with his hands. When of course it means you must steal no more working with your hands. But they called that the Thief's Bible, and it was corrected in later editions. But it's amazing the difference a comma in the wrong place can make. But Paul is teaching us here, what's the difference between being a thief and being a faithful Christian? And the difference is having something to give, sharing good things with others. He says not only that those who are stealing must stop stealing, but he says you've got to claim your own gifts, your own opportunities to do something positive, to do something useful, to do something helpful, so that you become a person who shares, a person who knows you have something to give and gives with others. So it's not enough to stop stealing. According to this verse, all of us are thieves until we become givers. And you know, when we withhold the good things we could share with others, we are stealing from them, aren't we? We're stealing our love, our ministry, our support, our friendship, and our fellowship. Now, this isn't just about stealing money or stealing possessions. It connects to what we've been saying about anger. And that is, when you're an angry person, you're more a taker than a giver in God's family. You're someone that people might avoid, or someone around whom people are especially careful not to say or do anything that might set you off. And if you live that kind of life, you're not adding something positive to God's work and God's people. You're a drag. You're taking, you're absorbing, you're making the fellowship of God's people less, not more. So, if you find that anger has you stealing the peace or the joy or the support or the capacity for close friendship with other people, it's time to stop stealing and come to deal with your emotions in a way that allows you to be a giver, so that you may help others and build them up. You're a thief until you give. That's a great challenge. Then in verse 29, Paul talks specifically about speech. One of the worst things that happens when anger gets a grip upon us is the words that we might say. Paul says, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths." Now notice, he doesn't say unwholesome thoughts may run through your mind, that you may be tempted, you might imagine what you'd like to say. But he says the problem comes when you let it come out of your mouth. In a moment of anger, we're all tempted to say and do things that strike back or in some way retaliate for us being hurt. But Paul says, bite your tongue. Have the discipline. Have the maturity to know that everything you think, you don't have to say. Everything you feel, you don't have to say, because of the difference it will make in your relationship with them. But only what is helpful, he says, for building others up according to their needs. Loving speech always has as its focus, how can I be a blessing to you? What do you need? What's it like to be you right now, whatever this moment in your life is, and how can I be your loving brother or sister to support you and help you as you walk through whatever you're facing? You see, when we're in a state of anger, it's usually about me, about the things of me and my rights and my feelings and all the rest. But Paul says, measure your speech by the measuring rod of, is this helping the other person? Am I thinking about their needs and not just mine? When you're angry, your need to feel important or smart or powerful may overwhelm the real needs of the situation. The other person may need to learn. They may need to grow. But it's not going to happen while you're in a state of anger. And the last phrase of that verse is also important, that it may benefit those who listen. Everyone watches to see how someone else is dealing with a potentially angry moment. Linda and I were in a restaurant one night. We'd stopped to have dinner, and during our meal, two employees got into an argument with each other. And some angry words were exchanged, and voices were raised, and finally, one of them left his post, and as he went through the door into the kitchen, banged it open with his fist, and the door just flapped back and forth two or three times. You know, we never felt the same about that Waffle House after that. Well, I kind of laugh when I say that. But people are watching you and me to see, how are we dealing with anger? And Christians have got to be sure that we don't act in ways that would get you fired at the Waffle House. He says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. How often is our behavior changed when we remember who's around, who's watching, who's with us? Children sometimes act drastically different when their parents are with them than when they're away. Employees sometimes work in a different way when the boss is around. But we as Christians need to remember that the Holy Spirit is a witness and can be a participant in all of our conversations with others, especially the difficult ones. And we don't want to break God's heart in how His children deal with the difficult times. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. And then he talks about things that we need to throw away. Junk that clutters up our lives. He says, get rid of all bitterness. Rage. That word rage is like blowing your top. Explosive anger, like a volcano erupting. Anger. This is anger like getting hot emotionally and staying that way. Kindling the fire of anger. Having a smoldering resentment toward others. Brawling, he says. Brawling, I heard one New Testament teacher describe it as like if you use a walkie-talkie or a CB radio, it's always having the talk button down. It's broadcasting but not listening. It's spewing on others without really paying any attention to who they are or what they need or what the situation needs. Slander. That's the same word that's used for blasphemy. Talking down another person. Assassinating their reputation in the eyes of others because you're angry. Along with every form of malice. Malice is trying to make yourself feel better by making others feel worse. And it doesn't work. Now, our motivation for all of this, and our guide, our example, and our strength to do it, is in Christ, of course. And in this final verse of this passage, Paul underscores that. He says, be kind. Kind means you give. If others have given to you or not, you give something good to them. And compassionate, that you think about the life the situation, the feelings, the needs of the other person. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another. Let it be a pattern that you deal with these differences and put them in the past, not that you let them pile up until they fall on you. Why? Why do we live this way? Forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Christians are always to remember that we belong to the God who came to us when we were at fault, when our sins had separated us from His holiness, from His presence, when we had fallen so far short of who He called and created us to be. He took the initiative to make it right by sending Jesus into the world to live and die and rise again, that we might have life, that we might be forgiven. Since we have received that priceless gift, we need to show that we believe in forgiveness. We need to deal with our differences by taking the initiative, by seeking the God-honoring outcome, by speaking the truth in love, by dealing with that enemy of anger so that we can get it out of the way and enjoy the feast of life with our Lord and with all of His children. That's a great challenge. It is for me. I bet it is for you too. I look forward to worshiping with you Sunday at 10:30 on Facebook. We're going to conclude our series on making peace this Sunday, looking at some passages from Genesis and Matthew and Colossians, some verses from all three of those books that show us how to close the deal of making peace, so to speak, being reconciled. Not just an internal experience, but an outward experience of being restored in our relationship with someone with whom we've had differences. I hope you'll tune in, and I hope that you'll share Sunday's worship with others. Invite them to be with you. As we part, I pray that in those moments when anger rears its head inside you, that you'll see it for what it is, a warning, an alarm, that you'll see beneath it to what's happening in your heart. And with confidence in God's love for you and His grace towards you, you'll work through that problem so that you can find peace in your heart and you can be restored in your relationship with someone else. In your anger, don't sin. I hope we all can live by that. God bless you. Thank you again for being here tonight.